Today, Radical Economics of the Left. I have spent an entire semester teaching you capitalist economics. That's what we do in United States colleges for the most part. There are radical leftists, communists, economists of alternate beliefs and models, but for the most part, we teach capitalist economics. From the very first day I was teaching you capitalist economics, the economics of greed, the economics of self-interest, the economics of exploitation. And I don't mean those words in bad senses. You know, from the very first day I was explaining to you, you are a bread maker, you make bread, but you're a lazy SOB. You waste resources. You hire your loser brother here. And you can charge a high price, waste resources, because you're the only game in town. Why would you be efficient with your use of resources? Why would you make a good product? People have to come to your store to buy. But in a world where other people can enter markets, where other people have the incentive of self-interest to enter markets, you could come into that market and say, well, you lazy son of a bitch, you are wasting resources. I can do this better by simply being more efficient with my use of resources. I won't spill flour on the floor. I won't hire my lazy brother unless he actually gets productive. I won't waste resources, and therefore I can just charge a lower price simply by exploiting resources more efficiently. We call that static efficiency. Static efficiency is the use of existing resources with a given technology at the most efficient level. Static efficiency. But you see, they can go even further. We could go to someone like you. Well, yeah, he's using resources really efficiently, but I can think of a better way to arrange factors of production and apply them to those resources. Why is it better? Because this new technology that I have in mind will use fewer resources. And in fact, it might even use the factors of production more efficiently. A rearrangement of the factors of production, a refinement of the factors of production, moving to a new technology to gain resource efficiency. That is dynamic efficiency. Dynamic efficiency. And in all of this, as I taught you from the very beginning of this course, the purpose of doing this, of using resources more efficiently, of inventing new technologies, was not because you love yourself those customers. Well, you might, but who cares? The reason you did it was because you wanted someone else's money. You wanted someone else's customers. You wanted someone else's profit. He was profiting. You wanted what he had. So you took it because you could. You wanted what he had. So you took it because you could. Greed was not an evil. Greed was a motive force of efficiency and resources and innovations and technology. That is the power of capitalism, to give us an incentive. Our private property is ours, and we have the liberties to use that property as we wish and to rent factors of production and apply them to the resources that we gain to make money, to bear risk for an expected return. It is an engine of production. No one can deny what has been the great American success story. People who actually went out, busted their asses, and got things produced. More and more for everybody through this system. And there's another part to it, too. It's not just a matter of being cheapo special with the use of resources. You also have to produce a product that customers would like. As I had told you before, you cannot go out and put a sign over your shop that says, my bread tastes like ass, because no one will buy ass bread. Unless you're into that kind of thing. You know, there's a niche market, I suppose. But you know, you can't sell ass bread. It has to taste decent. It has to not kill people with ass smell. So, in other words, there would be a quality drive in there too. Because if you're producing nasty bread, someone else could do the same technology as you if they can get your technology out of your hands, and you can produce bread and you'll say, my bread doesn't taste like ass. Bring your kids in. Kids eat free and it's not ass bread. And again, this has nothing to do with your customers and how much you want them to have a healthy, nutritious meal at a low price. We say that in business because we have to. Our customers want to hear us say that. They really do. But at the end of the day, what really matters is whether or not we make profit. You are not there for the customers. You are there to drive him out of business, put him into bankruptcy, and make their kids go to a community college. Or, you know what I mean, given that this is a community college. Look, in all of what I have taught you, there has been this understanding that we must be allowed, within a circumscribed framework, to have greed play its hand. Remember what I told you in economics. We assume that more is preferred to less. More of life, more of health, more of money, more of toys, more of ass. We want everything. Do you not want butt? Of course you do. Do you not want a decent cheeseburger? Double. Extra grease and bacon. Of course you want that. You want these things. And it's okay. It's not an evil. The church told you at one time, it's an evil to be greedy. Where are we if we cannot reach out and get what we want? And part of that is being allowed to use our private property for the purpose of production. And if we make the money, we get to keep the money. And if we do better than someone else, then we get more of the money. And if we are losers, we just have to suffer. We suck hind tit if we can't get out there and bust our asses and make a buck. But here's the problem. All along, I've been talking like this. This more is preferred to less. Greed is okay. All of those great things about our lives that we have, our toys, are driven by our greed. You don't say, no, I don't want no ass tonight. No, I don't want no meal tonight. Of course we do. We cannot deny our nature. Our nature compels us to hunt and to go for blood. That's in our nature. And anyone who says it is not is just plain wrong. But that's not all there is to the story. Everything I've taught you so far was really about capitalism. Even when I talked about the great revolution of the Franklin Delano Roosevelt administration, that was still within the framework of capitalism. He didn't abolish the banks. He didn't abolish the rich. He didn't abolish the brokerage houses. He did not abolish all of those things that had brought the country to its knees with its excesses. He didn't do that. He toyed with them. He used them as his political whipping boy. But he kept the capitalist system. Oh, here's some money. You don't have a job. The classical economist would have said, you don't have a job, die. As a matter of fact, one of the presidential debates a few months ago, there was a discussion, what would you do if this person needed health care and he didn't have health care? One of the presidential candidates, his supporters in the audience, just hollered out, die, die. Well, that's a good way. That gives you an incentive not to lose your job, not to lose your health care, because you'll die if you don't. But you see, at the same time, we assume that sooner or later you've got to be able to get on your own feet, even under an FDR type program, even under the welfare we used to have. There was this presumption that sooner or later you need to get a job, you need to work, and that's your responsibility to do that. Here's the thing though. That very first lecture, I laid out the factors of production for you. And right there, I had you. I had you in a capitalist frame of mind, and I milked it for the entire semester. Sure, I gave you a few liberal things. Well, our income inequality is getting worse, and it wasn't really great to begin with, and you know, we have a high infant mortality rate and all of that kind of stuff, but really, at the end of the day, I've been teaching capitalism all along. But here's the problem. From the very first day, I was giving you sets of assumptions that you could have challenged. Of course, if you had in front of me in a class, I would have eaten your asses off. But I said, here's the factors of production. And this is a very simplistic way to talk about it. There's land, the physical platform upon which production occurs. Then there is physical capital, which is this catch-all category that goes from paperclips and pencils to buildings and fleets of trucks to computers and networks. Physical capital is a broad category, and certainly within it, refinements happen that are part of technological innovation. But then I gave you the next two factors of production, which are like a pair, labor and human capital. Labor is brute animal force. You as nothing but a beast of burden, a donkey, a sweating, strapping man standing in the sunlight in a field, needing nothing but his wife beater shirt and maybe a little bit of company with the Duchess at the end of his hard work day. Anyway. That's labor. Just everyone can do basic animal labor, and so you merit nothing more than a subsistence wage for it. But then there is the other factor of production, which is the improvement of labor. That's human capital. Human capital develops from labor through education, through training, through work experience. Just through your life, you become more understanding, more wiser, and all of that. But they are different because human capital is not in overabundance, especially in some way, in some fields. If you get the education or if you have great knowledge, human capital can give you the power to command a good wage simply because there are not many people who have this skill. And the more of these skills that are rare and needed that you have, the greater the wage that you can command. And by the way, of course, as I had said, we usually lump labor and human capital together under the term labor, but they really are different. You are here not because you love economics. You are here because you want to get out of being just an animal and getting a subsistence wage and get some better work. Know this, though, we can all go back to working for subsistence wage. So we always, always participate in that perfectly elastic supply curve of labor where you need nothing but your muscles to do the work. And then I went to the last factor of production. The one that is characteristic in capitalist systems, it's called equity. Now equity has two faces, but they're not two different factors because essentially they boil down to the same thing. Spending money to get a return. Hoping to get a return, I should say. Look, equity has an investment form. You put your money directly into an operation, you claim ownership, you claim residual cash flows after the bills have been paid, and you get to keep the rest of it. And then there is the sweat equity variation where you actually surrender the opportunity cost of something else you could do to claim ownership over an enterprise, bearing risk for an expected return. That's the whole discipline of finance in sort of a nutshell. Bearing risk for an expected return. The equity factor brings together the other four factors, uses a technology to apply those factors of production to resources to create an output. Again, the equity factor is the factor that brings the other four factors together, bearing risk in so doing, and applies those factors to resources for the purpose of creating output. It does this because it expects a reward. It expects a some kind of profit above and beyond just simply a couple of bucks. It expects something good for taking on the risk of combining the other factors of production together. Now, I should say something here about technology. I need to point this out one last time in this course. In the hubris of our modern times, we use the term technology as if all that means is the technology of computers, the technology of cell phones, high technology. Technology is all around us. Well, it always has been. We always have to use some technology to create an output. We apply factors of production using a technology. It could be a technology of making spear points. It could be a technology of making steel rods. It could be a technology of making cars. But there's always a technology involved in the production of output. And it is that equity factor that applies a technology on factors of production, like land, physical capital, labor, and human capital, to create output. So one last time, factors of production, land, physical capital, labor, and human capital, and then the equity factor. And therein lies where, in an idealized world where we really did have a dialogue in a classroom, you would have said, stop right there. What the hell did you just say to me? And I say to you, wait, what do you mean, what did I just say to you? I know exactly what I said to you, and I wonder if any of you ever, it probably didn't occur to you, because in a classroom, you're writing your notes, you're trying to get what I am saying. Listen again to what I said. The factors of production, land, physical capital, labor and human capital, and equity. Do you hear what I did from the first day forward? You are nothing but another factor of production. You're a piece of land. You're like a truck. You're like a computer. You're nothing but an engine of my profit. Nothing at all, any of you. I can substitute you for a jackhammer, or I can substitute a jackhammer for you. I can get rid of you just like I can get rid of a machine. I can put a burden on your back just like I can put a burden on the back of a building or even a donkey. I treat you like that this whole semester, and not one of you would have said, even if it had occurred to you, why are you doing that? Listen carefully at the machines in the construction zones around here. Do you hear any of them saying, boy, I've really got to work hard because my kids are going to go to college and I've got to save for them? Do you ever hear a machine say that? Do you ever hear a piece of land say, well, geez, I don't have health care, so if I get sick, how am I going to pay for my doctor bills? You don't hear that because they are machines. They are dirt. They are soulless, and you are not. And yet in economics, look what I did to you. I just turned you into something that I could get rid of if I didn't want it. I could hire it if I wanted it. I could pay it the minimum that I needed to for my static efficiency and for my dynamic efficiency. I could get rid of you without thinking about it, because my demand for you is a derived demand, derived from the need for me to make a profit off my final products. That's what capitalist economics boils down to. I drive you into believing that you are nothing but a complement or a substitute with other factors of production. I'm going to fire you because I have a computer that's a whole hell of a lot cheaper than you are. Well, maybe if you get some more of that human capital training, we'll hire you again so that you can crawl to that computer. Please don't put your coffee cup near that computer. You know what? That computer is sensitive. And that's why I always told you people I don't want ever to see coffee in this classroom. Shut up. God, that's drunk. Oh, that's the vodka. Never mind. It's okay. Know this. There are alternate ways to think about the economics of life, to think about our relationship to our productive selves. Most people think, well, I've worked for the weekends. Oh, God, I have to go to work today. But really, work is part of us. It is actually one of our basic needs. Because through our work, we are expressing the greatest of our powers, the power to create with our muscles, with our minds. We are at our best when we work. Even if I gave you the chance to just sit on your ass for the rest of your life drinking pina coladas and having someone wipe your ass because you were too lazy to do that, you would say, I gotta do something. So you go play World of Warcraft or something like that, or Skyrim. No, but we can't just do nothing. It is part of us. Just like food and sex are basic needs, work is a basic need. And if that is denied to us, it is like taking away our food, taking away our chance for a piece of ass. So at the end of the day, when you go to work, think about it this way. I'm having a meal and some butt. Okay, it's not quite like that. But in the 1700s, in the 18th century, a great deal of intellectual power was being brought to bear on the relationship between a person and his society, usually as reflected through the government of that society. It was truly the age of enlightenment, and thinkers were going in various directions. You had some thinkers who were talking early on, before Adam Smith, about the importance of private property and a set of liberties that would go with it, so that we would have the right to do what we wanted with what was ours, and then we would have the liberty to exploit that property in ways that we could make money. Or at least certainly no one was going to say, you can't do this with your private property, especially if it was going to produce something that other people wanted and it wasn't adverse to public policy. This understanding was emerging before Adam Smith, the father of economics. Before Adam Smith, this understanding was emerging that private property was a very important thing to recognize. You have what's yours. You have the right to exploit it, to enjoy it in quiet comfort if that's what you wish. There's an exploitation. And also to use the resources on it in a way that would produce output so that you would make money and provide good stuff or something for the society at large. This understanding of the role of a government in according people civil liberties and property rights was quite noticeable, and as it affected our founding fathers. They certainly, when you look at the Constitution, there is this clear indication that they were keyed on liberties, and especially liberties that had to do with rights, especially property rights. You have the right to be secure in your home against undue search and seizure. You have the right to speak your piece if you're a journalist and to disclose information. You have the right to assemble. Your body itself can come together with other people for the purpose of just having fun or for the purpose of seeking redress against your government. Rights were very important to these people, and private rights were important to these people. But they were not the only thinkers. I key on one particular notable figure in the 1700s, a Frenchman named Jean-Jacques Rousseau. I present him as sort of monolithic in his thinking, but it was clear through his life, through his writings, that he was evolving in his conceptualizations of the relationship between individuals, groups of people, and their society and their government. He wrote on many subjects. He was a gadfly in some ways. He served as a diplomat for a while, I guess. He was a writer. He poses as a thinker, perhaps an expert in education. He wrote quite a piece on education, challenging the existing institutionalized, rigid system of education that was popular then and now. But he turned his attention to society and people in it. Look, you and I both know that at our worst, we are assholes. We are mean sons of bitches. We can be nice, but when you come down to it, we have some really mean things inside of us that come out. That blood hunter, that uncaring person, that individual who wants his at the expense of everyone else, and he will hurt other people in his pursuit of that. Just last week, during the Christmas holiday season, there was a video of a man. He had had a heart attack in a big box store. He was lying on the ground while shoppers were stepping around him. Truth be told, I would have too, if it had been a good special on the other side of that son of a bitch. But no one helped him for a while. He twitched off. He died. What the hell? Who cares? One less shopper trying to get at that merchandise that's on sale. We see this all the time around us. Most people won't stop to help. Most people are too interested in themselves. If you have a choice between you and somebody else, you will think of you first. Now, the Good Samaritan comes through. I do not deny the power of people to be helpful to each other. But that's not what we really are at our hearts. We are greedy. I will take what is mine. And what is mine is what I take in this world. Jean-Jacques Rousseau said, this whole thinking is wrong. He said, there was a time when we were in communion, in grace, if you will, with nature. Now, of course, that's the story of just about every religion. There was a better time before. Hell, I see a better time when I was alive. This 21st century sucks. We all do that. We start our ideas by saying, well, there was this better time in the past. And he did that. He said, okay, there was this better time when we were in harmony with nature, and we are nature, so we were in harmony with one another. We had an understanding that we gave to our society, and our society gave without question to us. A bond of trust existed that if I give all I have, my whole life, to my society, then that society will, in a social contract, be obligated to give back to me all that it has. I need work. It is not a question. Of course I have work. I need food. Of course you have food. The society provides it for you. Because you give everything you have to your society, the society, there's no question. Are you sick? Of course you get to go to the doctor and get help. Are you cold? Are you in need of a place to live? Of course we'll do that for you because you do all you have for us. You give to us entirely, and we as a body, as a society, expressed through a government, give all to you. You understand that this is not some kind of socialism. This is something deeper. This is a commitment that we would have to a world where there's no question. There's not get a job. It's here's a job. It's not you need to get a job if you want health care. And if you're using government welfare funds, then you're nothing but a welfare queen, and I spike you, and I will make fun of you, and I will put my presidential candidacy up there to get rid of you welfare queens. There's nothing like that in this society. The trust is complete and pure. You give everything you have, and the society gives everything it has back to you. In that way, you are in an intimate bond. You and the society really are not two different things in that kind of a world. You have to give up civil liberties in a world like that. You can't have private property. Private property in the Rousseau model was where we fell from the grace of communion with each other and with all around us. You have yours and I have mine. Don't you dare step on my property because this is mine. My shit is stuff, your stuff is shit, as one comedian said long ago. But you see, you come on my property, I can kill you. In the Anglo-Saxon system, my property is sacrosanct. And you know what? I will teach my kids from the very earliest days of their lives This is ours. No one but our blood comes onto this property. It was called the Genga Walken. You would walk the kids around the property. Even in my day, my Germanic ancestors, I heard the stories of them doing this, the Genga Walken. Don't you dare cross my property. I will put up my fence, and within my fence I will put up my walls, and within my walls I will put up my rooms, and within my rooms I will put up all of the defenses I need to keep you from having anything that is mine, because mine is mine to exploit the way I see fit. Do you see what he's saying? Rousseau is saying, look what that does to us. It alienates us from each other. And certainly religion begins to play a part in this, because our government plays the game of separating us. Our churches play the game of separating us. I am a Christian. You, sir, are going to hell. You are a Muslim. I am an infidel. I am going to hell. You are a Buddhist. You can make me one with everything. If you're a hot dog vendor, too. I couldn't stand it. I'm sorry. Easy, easy. Look, you see what we're doing to each other with our religion? Our government plays us against each other. Our politicians live and thrive on gaming us. Well, you know, there's that liberal crowd out there, and they're just all for welfare for everybody, especially for themselves, because they're too lazy to get a job. And the liberals say, well, the right-wing conservative Tea Party activists, they want to keep all their taxes for themselves. They don't understand how much we have given to them of our society. And then they don't want high taxes. We play each other as much as we can. There is no consent. There's only a dynamic tension. Consent, 50.1% of the voters, there you go. That's your winner in a political election. Not a consent of all the people, just enough to get you by until the next election. And if it's a presidential election, it will cost about $1 billion. And you'll have to get that from some pretty damn rich people and institutions. We are driven to greater and greater alienation through a government that does not give us trust, through our religions that teach us that we must be cleansed of our original sin, that others around us are questionable. We must test their faith. Government and religion work together, even to this day. In Rousseau's time, it was very obvious. It was very clear. Matter of fact, there was an existentialist French writer, Albert Camus. He had this one scene in one of his plays where this priest was standing behind a cross. He was holding at a sinner, and the priest was saying, Ajonouille avant la croix. Kneel before the cross. Beg for forgiveness from the cross. Of course, I'm standing right behind it as the priest. Really? Hi there. You're begging to me. Oh, there's a God behind me, but beg to me. And put some coins in the communion, plate. Rousseau said, we can still have religion, but it's got to be a private matter. We cannot let that be part of the society's social contract. The social contract has to be a pure and perfect binding agreement between all of the citizens as a whole, each of the citizens as an individual, and the society itself, so that there really is no longer a separation of these things. There is the individual, the society, and the government that represents that society, but it represents all three because all three are one. You would imagine, you could imagine the political wag of the time, Voltaire saying, "Ah, Jean-Jacques, you would have us return to the trees and live as monkeys." No, and Rousseau would say, "No, we can live better. We have minds." We understand the consequences. We have seen the consequences of centuries, millennia of wars and greed and hate and all that comes of it. Can't we finally say, stop it? We are not monkeys. We are smarter than monkeys. We can live in peace with each other and understand why that is the best of all possible worlds. I take you to the 19th century, the early 19th century, to a professor, a German fellow, Prussian, named Georg Hegel, H-E-G-E-L, Georg Hegel. Now, in what I'm saying here, I shall conceive right away that I'm being quite simplistic. I try not to be misleading, but I will be simplistic. But I will try, and I will try to get to the heart of Hegel's way of thinking. He was a philosopher, professor, very influential on a group of his students who came to be known as the Young Hegelians. The Young Hegelians. Now, you probably wouldn't recognize most of the names. You would recognize one, I'm sure. Well, I hope. But there were a number of these students that came out of his shadow and his teachings and applied his way of thinking about problems to various issues of their day around them. And they rocked Europe. And ultimately, to some extent, they rocked the United States too. They rocked Asia. Their influence still is felt to this day, even if you would not recognize their names, even if you would repudiate what they said, you would have to recognize the importance of their thinking. Hegel worked did it like this. He said, okay, I want you, whenever you look at something that's going on in the world around you, or if you're looking at something that happened historically, think about it this way. There was at one time a thesis, essentially an institutionalized paradigm. Everyone bought into it. This is how we do it. This is how we see the world. As a matter of fact, it could even affect your perception so much that you wouldn't be able to see another way. Oh, well, this is obviously how we do things. It could be an institution, it could be laws, it could be a social order, whatever. There is a standard, and everyone buys into it, or pretty much everyone buys into it. Ultimately, though, it gets old and sterile, fossilized. Challenges arise to it. People are hurt by this paradigm, and there is a backlash. Now, I've always been of the mind that the backlash usually comes from young people who don't quite understand how important the traditions are. But they come at the paradigm, the standing paradigm, and they say, this is not the way it should be. So against the thesis, will inevitably, with historic inevitability, arise an antithesis, sooner or later. False starts and then fizzled plans, but sooner or later a real and serious antithesis comes up against the thesis. And then there is a clash of this thesis and the antithesis. You might even argue, although I wouldn't, that what you are seeing with the Occupy Wall Street is the beginning of perhaps a failed, but certainly an earnest antithesis to the standing orthodoxy. The thesis and the antithesis clash. They clash hard. They clash to such an extent that neither can survive the conflict. And what comes out is a synthesis that is the blend, the understanding between and the acceptance of a new order that comprises the traditions and the old paradigm with the innovations and the idea and new ideas of the antithesis. So it's thesis, antithesis comes to synthesis. But ultimately, the synthesis becomes the thesis. And so, finally, there has to be an antithesis against that. And then there's a clash again. And then ultimately a new synthesis, which ultimately becomes the thesis for the next round. History moves in this cycle. Thesis, antithesis, synthesis, becoming thesis, inviting antithesis, and finally to a new synthesis that is a thesis. Understand what Hegel was saying. History is not about conflict. History is conflict. History is conflict. And more importantly, History does not repeat itself. History fulfills itself, as one much later philosopher said. History doesn't repeat. Historical inevitability is not about, well, history just keeps doing the same thing over and over again. Well, yes, but that's only because if you have the same processes happening, you shouldn't be too surprised if the same outcomes occur. You go down the road of the Roman Empire and spank me, Jesus, you will fall like the Roman Empire. When we think that we have somehow found the special relationship with God as the Empire of the United States, that's about when it's time for us to notice, we are actually going down the same road. And historical inevitability will overwhelm us, and the Visigoths will march into Rome once again. Not again. Again, not because history repeats itself, but because it fulfills itself. On us, just like it has, on all of these empires before us, the Scythians, the Greeks, the Minoans, the Romans, the Etruscans, the Mayans, the Aztecs. All of them fell because history fulfilled itself for them as well. Hegel's students came out with modeling in this thesis, antithesis, synthesis way, problems that were of particular interest to them, and also looking for the inevitability of history to occur. I'll bring up one, before I bring up the main show, I'll bring up one, I'm pretty sure you've never heard of it. His name was Feuerbach, Friedrich Feuerbach. He was one of the young Hegelians, and his interest was in taking on the Prussian aristocracy and religion, and specifically the church, and that was not a particularly bright way to have a productive and happy life, bugging the hell out of the rich, powerful people in secular society and the rich, powerful people in religious society. But here's what he contributed. In a nutshell, and again, I am simplifying these ideas a lot. Here's what he said about religion. We make our God perfect. We imagine an unblemished, all-powerful, all-knowing, unsinful being as our supreme being to whom we must owe our worship. And when we do that, we have immediately created within ourselves alienation, because you know what? We are not perfect. We cannot be perfect. And so every time we reference this God, we reference something that is better than us. We reference something that if it decides to send us to heaven, it is because it pities us. Because as the Bible says, our righteousness is but filthy rags to the Lord. We are born with original sin. You want sex. You want food. You are dirty. You carry with you bad from the very beginning of your life. You need salvation, whether it is through Jesus or through some other Messiah or religious leader. You are wrong and you must be enlightened. Buddha sits there on his fat ass and tells you that you must come to his standards. The people who wrote after Jesus, and I am not making this point about Jesus himself because this wasn't what he said, but they said, well, you know, Jesus said you'll go to hell. Actually, Jesus said you're going to, he was using a metaphor. He said you'll go out to the dump on the edge of town. It's always on fire. It was in that day. But, oh, you'll go to hell if you don't accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Oh, you don't believe in Muhammad? Well, you're an infidel and you deserve to die at the blade or at the bomb. Look at what we do to ourselves when we create a God that is so much better than us that we cannot have anything that he really likes, because everything we do is just filthy rags to him anyway. Why are we doing this to each other? It makes us alienated. It makes us feel dirty. When we want sex, sex is dirty. When we want to eat a lot of food, that's nasty to do that. When we have impure thoughts, that's wrong. We alienate ourselves from ourselves with making a perfect God that will never be like. So anything that he does for us is because he is just such a great, big, grand beneficent fellow. You can imagine in this regard that God would say, who are you to question me? And we would answer, I am your creation. Who else is going to question you? You made me. Why did you make me so wrong if you love me? Why do you make a God like that if you have any dignity at all for yourself? Feuerbach obviously didn't get a lot of fans, but he made the point clear. It wasn't Rousseau, well, you can have your private religion if you want. He was saying, you've got to get rid of all religion, because anytime you have a religion, you are going to have this alienation happen. I can't be right. I can't be right with my God, so you're not right with me. Get out of my property. God hates me, so by God, I'm going to hate the world around me. Well, I'll pretend I love everyone, but you're going to go to hell anyway, obviously. See, this young Hegelian was part of a process of breaking the bond of all thinking with a God. In the Age of Enlightenment, those good thinkers did not repudiate the existence of God. They simply said, we would like to learn about our world, our universe, ourselves, without reference to faith. We would like to do that, but we still recognize that there's a God. These young Hegelians were not going to give in on that point. Enough of it! No more! Because we are never going to have a society that is truly good until we stop seeing ourselves as bad. Another young Hegelian you will recognize, his name was Karl Marx. He was born in 1818, Jewish father. He married just an absolutely wonderful, wonderful woman, Jenny von Westphalen. And she worked like a dog for him. One of my great criticisms, personally, of Marx was that he'd sit on his fat ass thinking about the great problems of the world. While she was out literally scrubbing floors, cleaning clothes for rich people, just worked like an animal. And then she was so devoted to him, she would copy everything things that he would write in multiple copies and send them to publishers. Just a wonderful woman. And one thing interesting was she was actually born of noble blood. She didn't have any money early on, but eventually there was one of her relatives died, and she and Karl Marx gathered quite a bit of money, and they lived the last part of their life quite comfortably. Marx died in 1883, but she lived after him, and she was a strong force in promoting Marxist writings, Marx's own writings and others. Especially Marx got involved with a young man, a son of an industrialist, a rich kid named Friedrich Engels, and the two, I think they met in the Netherlands, but they collaborated on some of the major works that you will see attributed to Marx. They were actually Marx and Engels working together. They fought very much alike. And if I'm not mistaken, Engels did support financially Marx to some extent. I'm sure that really thrilled Engels' dad, but there you go. But Marx, let me give you an idea of how powerful Marx was in his thinking, why it was so driven. He didn't want ideas that were sort of like his. He was quite intolerant of people who didn't have ideas like his, that were exactly what he was thinking. And he was fierce. In the days when they were poor, Marx had been thrown out of Germany, he'd been thrown out of Paris. Everywhere he went, he wrote and pissed people off, and he ended up in England, in London, living in a two-room flat. It was an ungodly, awful, miserable place. It was so awful that in the cold of the winter, one of his daughters died. Their economic lot was so bad that they actually had to put the little girl's body in the colder of the two rooms to keep it from rotting while they figured out what to do with it. Jenny, the little girl's mom, went out and begged for the money so that the body could be taken away and buried. A Frenchman lent her the money for that. I want you to imagine what it would be like to live in a time like that, to be a great, powerful thinker, and to all your theories, all your learning from your college days, it all comes to reality when you are carrying a little lifeless body into another room to keep it fresh because you can't afford to bury it because the capitalist system has ensured that you don't get anything because you don't deserve it because you have nothing to give to the controllers of capital. Marx put it in very stark terms. Look, it's your labor. It is the essence of you and you and you. It is your blood. It is your life. And yet we have this equity factor that I talked about. It gets to have the lion's share and it pays you a pittance wage. And then if you aren't needed anymore, it just dispenses with you while it rolls on. You get your layoff. If economic times are bad, but the CEO still gets his goddamn salary. Look at what that does to you. It makes you mean. I will hide in my house behind my fence. I will watch my TV and I will play my stupid music because I don't want to deal with a world where I am dispensable. I am a substitutable factor of production. While the rich, the controllers of capital, get richer and they squeeze out even the middle class. You think your college education is going to guarantee you a job. You are wrong. I know that. I am a professor. I'm watching kids struggling just to find work these days. It will get worse and they will keep pushing the system and pushing it. They don't learn. Do you know that in the middle of September of 2008, the entire world's financial system almost came to a grinding halt? Do you know that? Did that stop the banks and the brokers? Did that even make the government suddenly realize we have got to change this? No, because your presidential candidates are the one side, and on the other side, they were all beholden for their money to the same controllers of capital, because politics is capital, and they control it just like they control you. How dare you want a higher wage through a union? What the hell do you think you are? Do you think your labor is yours? Do you think all that learning you did is yours? Do you think that your sweat of your brow is yours? How dare you? We'll rent you at the lowest wage possible because hell, that's static efficiency. And then we'll invent technologies to get rid of you as much as we can because hell, a computer can do it a lot more than you can because we know your generation is a bunch of dumbasses and we'll degrade you and embarrass you and humiliate you. In our news media, you don't have any education. You're not as good as the Chinese. You sit down on the street to try to fight the existing status quo, the blades of empire will cut you down, I guarantee it. Those Occupy Wall Street idiots, they didn't get it. The controllers of capital will have theirs to the very last drop of your blood. Marx called on the workers of the world to unite. You have nothing to lose but your chains now. Why are you still defending a system that rents your labor when it needs it and gets rid of you when it doesn't need it, that spites you, says you get health care only if you're a good little boy or girl and you have the right kind of job? We're not going to give you health care at the national level. We're going to play a political game, Democrats and Republicans. Democrats will compromise. Republicans will scream that there's more they want. But all of them are working for themselves and the controllers of capital. You see, at the end of the day, you are standing with your backs to the sunset. You are going to walk through darkness. I promise you. You can either be consumed by that darkness or you can carry a torch through that darkness. But here's a better idea. Instead of carrying the torch, why don't you be the torch? Because if you decide that you can be the torch and you serve that purpose, then you will find that on the other side, when the day breaks, you were the morning. History is not about conflict. History is conflict. Now all of you go out and make history. That's all.